أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. طب القلوب ودوائها ونور أبصارها وعلى أهل بيته الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. قال الله تبارك وتعالى في محكم كتابه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وكونوا مع الصادقين. آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وآله. First of all, we thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for gracing us with this wonderful moment, wonderful opportunity tonight, being the night that marks the birth anniversary of our beloved Imam, Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayh. In this short space of time, I'm very, very much delighted, respected brothers and sisters, to be with you in this second half of the holy month of Ramadan. And tonight being the night of the birth anniversary of our beloved Imam, my topic of discussion will be to look at few lessons from the life of our beloved Imam alayhi salatu wassalam. And the discussion will center around Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam and the plight of the needy. How Imam alayhi salatu wassalam taught us to reach out to those people who are less advantaged in our communities and in our societies. And from tomorrow night, inshallah, we will begin with our main discussions on the spiritual dimension of Islam and spiritual dimension of the holy month of Ramadan. And the aim behind the discussion will be to encourage brothers and sisters to be more spiritual in this holy month of Ramadan and to try as much as we can to get closer to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as that is one of the main aim of all the act of worships and ibadah that Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained that we should do, especially in this holy month of Ramadan. No doubt celebrating the birth anniversaries of our beloved Imam or commemorating their departures from this world as a very strong root from the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wassalam. And I want to share this very beautiful tradition from our beloved Imams as to the importance and significance of attending to the majalis where the lives of Ahlul Bayt are being celebrated, where the legacies of Ahlul Bayt are given life, where we remember our beloved Imams, and of course, the work that our beloved Imam did when they were alive. This is a very beautiful tradition. Maybe some of us heard of this tradition before or not, but it will be a lesson and an encouragement and motivation to each and every one of us whenever we attend the majalis of Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wassalam. Look at the tradition. Shi'atuna khuliku min fadilitinatina wa ujinu bima'i wilayatina fa in khaffat mawazinahum fathakilha bifadili hasanatina. This is a very beautiful riwaya that tells us the reward of those Shias and lovers of Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wassalam who remember the lives of Ahlul Bayt and celebrate the lives of Ahlul Bayt. And here when you look at this riwaya, our beloved Imam alayhi salatu wassalam made mention of the word Shia. My Shia or our Shia, خُلِكُوا مِنْ فَاضِلِتِينَتِنَا. They are created from the remnants of the substances that we are created from. So therefore, it is not by chance or coincidence that a person becomes a Shia. It is through the tawfiq of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah showered His mercy and benedictions upon each and every one of us to become a lover and a follower of Ahlul Bayt. So therefore, خُلِكُوا مِنْ فَاضِلِتِينَتِنَا. our shias are from us. وعجنوا بماء ولايتنا. Our shias are removed and squeezed from the water of our wilaya. Here's an expression from our beloved Imam alayhi salatu wasalam, that whoever find him or herself on the road of a wilaya and the love of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam, you should know that this wilaya is made known to Ahlul Bayt that this person will be on the fold of wilaya. Then Imam said, فَإِنْ خَفَّتْ مَوَازِينُهُمْ فَثَكِّلْهَا بِفَاضِلِ حَسَنَاتِنَا. If our Shia, out of maybe forgetfulness, or sometimes out of negligence, they are unable to live up to expectations in accordance to the teachings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the scale of their deeds and actions are below standard, Imams are making dua. فَثَكِّلْهَا بِفَاضِلِ حَسَنَاتِنَا. Ya Allah, make their scales standard through our a'mals, we Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. So Ahlul Bayt, they are making dua for each and every one of us in their salat, in their ibadat, in their a'mal. Tonight is the night of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, and this is one beloved Imam that we cannot forget about him, because Imam, very unfortunately, Imam was mazloom in his life, and after his life he's still mazloom. Even today, it is not easy, very, very difficult for the lovers of Imam to stand by where Imam is buried to recite once more Fatiha. So this is an opportunity for us to show our love to our beloved Imam alayhi salatu wassalam, and to continue to strengthen and renew our allegiance with our beloved Imam, and that will go a long way in ensuring that we receive the shafa and intercession of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wassalam. And no doubt the fada'il of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba cannot be overemphasized, because wherever you find a riwayah from Rasulullah about Aba Abdullah, you will find a riwayah about Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salatu wassalam. When Rasulullah said, Husaynun minni wa ana min Husayn, the same thing, we have a riwayah, Al-Hasan minni. And we have a riwayah also from Rasulullah, Al-Hasan wal Husayn imamani qama aw ka'ada. Hasan and Husayn, they are imam, whether awake or standing. So therefore, Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salatu wassalam is imam that we need to celebrate his life. Now let's begin with our discourse. And the discussion will be very brief discussion, being the first night. And tomorrow, as I mentioned, you all come, inshallah, we will begin with the very, very important and serious discussions on spiritual dimensions of our lives and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aspire each and every one of us to achieve. It will be more spiritual and more philosophical. We're going to look at how Imam reached out to those who are less advantaged in the community. And to do that, we do it in three stages. The first stage, we study the situation that Imam alayhi salatu wassalam found himself in right after the shahada of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wassalam. And then we'll look at how Imam alayhi salatu wassalam helped out in that situation and that condition. And lastly, we'll look at few lessons that we can learn and take it back home, inshallah, in trying to implement those lessons in our lives. Because when you come for programs like this, the main aim of that program is to be able to take some lessons back home for you to be able to implement those lessons. Imam Ali Salatu Wassalam has a lot of virtues and fada'il. And one of those fada'il of the Imam, which manifested throughout the life of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salatu wassalam, is Imam's kindness and generosity. Imam Hassan alayhi salatu wassalam was very kind and very generous, to such an extent that his name Kareem Ahl al-Bayt. Imam alayhi salatu wassalam, like the way when you go to Qom, Bibi Fatima Masuma, his name Kareema to Ahl al-Bayt. Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salatu wassalam also was given that title, Kareem Ahl al-Bayt. Why? Because Imam was so generous. Imam reached out to so many people in that difficult condition and that difficult situation. And you know, of course, as we are taught in Islam, poverty is something which Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, through the teachings of our Prophet, taught us to try as much as we can to stay away from poverty. Because we are told sometimes a person may live in poverty as a result of some disability in his or her life. Or sometimes, no, not a disability. It's because of certain movement or condition, either political or social, that will make it difficult for a person to go and work. This social movement or political movement, Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba found himself in that situation. There are three factors that made it so difficult for our beloved Imam, and especially his lovers and followers. They were examined with a lot of poverties during that time. The first one is the system of Banu Umayyah. Banu Umayyah's system was such that majority of people were denied the resources of the country. People were not allowed to make enough money. And this you have it so many in the riwayat. For instance, Abu Ala al-Mawdudi, in his book, Kitabul Hikmah wal Khilafah, in that book he wrote very, very beautifully that Banu Umayyah, when they took the leadership, they brought a lot of changes. And when he discussed those changes, he made a point where he spoke about the changes in Baytul Mal. That they've changed completely the system, how Baytul Mal was run. And as a result of that, many Muslims suffered during that time, and they did not have a lot of money. Another one also, which Ibn Athir reported in his book, that some of the workers of Banu Umayyah, they reported to Hajjaj Ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi, who was then the governor or the leader in charge of Iraq, that when these people came to him to take Islam, they will become Muslims, because when you become a Muslim, you don't pay anything. But then after becoming Muslim, they will move to either Kufa and Basra. Then he mentioned to Hajjaj, Hajjaj wrote a letter to him and responded, go back to them, go to Basra, go to Kufa, take a lot of money from them. So it made a lot of people to struggle and go through many difficulties. The second condition which Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba found himself in was the wars that took place during the lifetime of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen. Number one is the Battle of Jamal. In the Battle of Jamal, historians taught us about 20,000 Muslims lost their lives. And in the Battle of Siffin, more than 70,000 Muslims lost their lives. And in the Battle of Nahrawan, almost more than 4,000 people lost their lives. And they left children, orphans. And they left widows. And Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba had to inherit this type of a situation. Another one, of course, is Muawiyah himself, where he made it so difficult. They got the money, they distributed the money to their own people, they built a lot of mansions, and Muslims were left in abject poverty. You know, Imam alayhi salatu wasalam, to see how Imam loved the Ummah, and his aim was not just about himself, but to reach out to the Muslim Ummah. Imam alayhi salatu wasalam, the first strategy he adopted, we all know, is to go into that peace treaty with Muawiyah. This is a very important peace treaty. Like the way Rasulullah went into that treaty with Quraysh in Sulh al-Hudaybiyah. And in that treaty, when you look at the fourth clause, the fourth agreement, it was about the plight of the Muslim Ummah and how to reach out to Muslim Ummah and to distribute the wealth of Muslim Ummah. Imam alayhi salatu wasalam, when he agreed with Muawiyah, number one point that he agreed with him is that the sunnah of Rasulullah must be protected. And number two, Imam said, the cursing of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen has to stop from Friday pulpit. And the third one, Imam said, you should stop killing Shias. And those who say they love Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, the fourth one, Imam said, in the Muslim treasury, there is 5,000, which is a blood money for those children and families who lost their husbands in the battle of Siffin, Jamal, and Nahrawan. Imam said, let's agree that we'll give that money back to them. And the fifth agreement we all know is that you should give the leadership either to me or to my brother Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. So Imam alayhi salatu wasalam, this was the first strategy he adopted to reach out to Muslim Ummah and to help them solve their problems, monetary and otherwise. Now, of course, Muawiyah did not live up to expectation. He did not live up to that agreement. He did not follow the agreement that they signed with Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. Example, Imam agreed with him, you should protect the sunnah of Rasulullah. Now, but he changed Jumu'ah to be Wednesday. Friday Salat now is Wednesday instead of Friday. So they did not protect the sunnah of Rasulullah. Number two, stop cursing Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen. Did they stop? No. They cursed Imam Ali on Friday pulpit for a period of 90 years. It was only Umar ibn Abdul Aziz who came and stopped the cursing of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Number three, Imam says, stop killing Shia. They killed a lot of Shias of Amir al-Mu'mineen. You find Umar ibn Amak al-Khuzai, Hijr ibn Adi al-Kindi. They killed all these people. They sent Sumra ibn Jundub to kill about 8,000 slavers and followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam. The fourth agreement is my point, where Imam says the money, which is in the Muslim treasury, that money has to go to the families of those martyrs who died in these three battles. Did he give the money? They did not give the money. Instead, they built a lot of mansions in Sham, and they were staying in those mansions. But at least Imam alayhi salatu wasalam made a move to reach out to Muslim Ummah and to solve the problems of Muslim Ummah and to help the Muslim Ummah to solve their problems. And also one thing, when you dissect about his life, you realize that in many instances, Imam alayhi salatu wasalam went out to help people. In so many cases, a person would come to Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. The moment he would arrive, Imam would look at the face of the person and would read that this person is having a challenge, is having a problem. Before the person would ask whatever he wanted, Imam would go inside and bring some money and give to this person. This is how Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam taught us. Like, if we have an example, one day some of his companions came and asked him, Ya Hassan al-Mujtaba, why is it that whenever a person comes to you asking for something, you do not hesitate? You do not even ask him, where are you coming from? The moment the person asks, you just give it to him. Why? Do you know whether the person is right or wrong? You know what was the response of Imam alayhi salatu wasalam? And this should serve as a lesson to the lovers and followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. Imam alayhi salatu wasalam responded by saying, oh people, do you know why I do not even think? Because inni lillahi sa'ilun wa fihi ragibun. Because I also ask Allah, and my interest is in Allah, that whatever I want, I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to give me. Akhsha an akuna sa'ilan wa arudda sa'ilan. I am afraid that I am a beggar who ask Allah, but when someone ask me, I reject that person. Imam said, I wouldn't do that. So Imam alayhi salatu wasalam in this riwayah taught us, you cannot reject someone who ask you. You need to reach out to that person. You need to be able to help that person. Like one day, Imam alayhi salatu wasalam was walking with his entourage, and then he met this person sitting next to a farm. And the person is crying and crying and crying. Imam came to him and asked him, what is your problem? Why are you crying so much? He said, I am a worker on this farm, and what I get as a payment is not enough for me, for my parents, and for my children. Imam said, what do you want me to do? He said, if I can get something that will grant me more salary, it will be much better than this work that I'm doing. Imam said, where is your master? The one who you are working under him. Let's go and meet him. They went to the boss. They met the boss. Imam told him, do you want to sell your farm or not? He said, yes, I want to sell half of my farm. Imam bought that half of the farm and gave it to this worker on the farm. So these are lessons that we can learn from the life of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salatu wasalam. And in conclusion, what are our duties and responsibilities as lovers and followers of Ahlul Bayt? No doubt we have duties and we have responsibilities. And when you go to the ad'iya and riwayat of Rasulullah and Ahlul Bayt al-Asma wa al-Tahara, you realize that there are so many instances where they make dua to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help them overcome poverty and pains in their life. One riwaya from Rasulullah, كَادَ الْفَكْرُ أَنْ يَكُونَ كُفْرًا. Some said, it is reported from Amir al-Mu'minin. By the way, they are all silsilatul dhahabiyya. Whether from Amir al-Mu'minin or Rasulullah, is the same. Yani, poverty is capable of making a person kafir. You wake up, you have nothing to eat. You have no proper, decent place to sleep. That might not help you in your life to be able to dedicate yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, today when you go to our communities, you go to our societies, and you find people who are trying their level best to make ends meet and to reach out to their needs, but they are unable to do so. Where is the cause for that? The cause will go back to the Muslim Ummah and Mu'mineen. As Muslims, we need to reach out to one another. And we need to learn this lesson from Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, who has inherited a very difficult life. Through the leadership of Umayya, they left a lot of poverty. Through the way and manner, they embezzled the Islamic fund. So when you see someone in our communities, in our societies, who is struggling so much, we need to try as much as we can to reach out to that person. Because Allah mentioned in Quran, وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا. There is not a living thing on the face of universe except that the sustenance of that living thing is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it is with Allah, then what Allah has given you, it is not only for you. It is for you and to share it with the mu'mineen and mu'minat, so that Muslims and Shias in particular will not find themselves into trouble. Therefore, Mawlai Kainat Amir al-Mu'mineen very beautifully mentioned in one riwayah, where Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen said, An-nasu ayalullah. People are the families of Allah. And since they are the families of Allah, kadadamina arzakahum wa kaddara akwatahum. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has guaranteed their livelihood and their rizq is with Allah. And then Imam at the end of that riwayah, he said, when Allah has given rich people a lot of money, they should know that in their money, the money of the poor people is also inside. And Imam at the end of the riwayah said, if you go to a community where you find so many rich people and there are those who are struggling, you should know that people are struggling not because of anything, but because of the negligence of those who are. Therefore, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala mentioned in Quran, وَفِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ حَقٌ لِلسَّائِلِ وَالْمَحْرُومِ. In their wealth, there is right for the one who asks and the one who does not ask. So therefore, brothers and sisters, in short, let us learn this lesson from our beloved Imam, Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salatu wassalam, and let's try as much as we can to implement this lesson of giving out for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and for the love of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wassalam. Hada wa billahi tawfiq, wassalamu alaykum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.